We're glad to be sharing the ministry of Redemption Church with you. Now join us as we receive the Word of God.
I went to high school with Eric, and Eric showed me so much in high school about just loving God. I've told you this story, and I've told these people also, but I'm going to tell this story again. We were at a UIL contest. We were out of the city in some other school and doing speech and debate stuff, real nerdy stuff. We were not the coolest of people, but that's all changed. A lot of that changed. All right. So I suddenly felt sick, and I was just like, man, I feel sick. And out of nowhere, my brother right here, Eric, just said, let's pray. And I got to tell you, that was a foreign concept to me at the age of 18. I'm like, no, it's not church. You pray at church. That's something you do at church. And Eric just like reached over and said, we're going to pray right now. And I'll never forget the simple prayer he prayed. It's like burnt in my head. He's like, God, I know that you love Chris, and the stripes of Jesus tell us that. And you said, with your stripes, Chris is sealed. I'm going to pray. You just prayed over me, just that simple. And it blew me away. That was evangelism right there, carrying Jesus outside of the walls of the church. And look, all these years later, this guy is still carrying Jesus outside of the walls of this church. Thank you so much, Eric, for leading us through our own city. We've not walked our own city, but you walked us through it yesterday. Isn't that awesome? I think we should walk our own city. What do you think? And it was so awesome. I remember some of the people we ran into yesterday. We were just carrying this cross. And I want you to know, we have this feeling in our hearts like, oh, we're probably bothering people. My goodness, this is probably like a nuisance on people. Or no, they were like, come over here, talk to us. Come over here. There's a lady named Miss Susan. Man, she wanted prayer, and we just started praying for her. She just broke right there on a park bench, just crying. We just embraced her. We just hugged her. Story after story was just like that. And Eric, what would you tell them? That's something they can only do when you're around?
No, you can do it without me.
We can do that all the time with the love of Jesus. Redemption Church, I think we should show that kind of love all the time. What do you think?
Amen.
All right. Amen, amen. I want to quickly remind you, Easter's coming next week, okay? You be here. Bring some friends with you, all right? Good Friday is coming this Friday, all right? It's going to be at our house. We're going to have a time of worship. We want you to be a part of that. But for right now, we're going to let this dude preach to us. Can you say these words with me? Preach to us. Eric Smith. Amen. And right here, we're on Facebook Live. If you can get out your phones, you can go ahead and share that. That's on our redemption page. Go ahead and share that. Hello, Facebook Live. Hello, podcast. Everybody, I give you Eric Smith.
So I'm Facebooking live.
You're Facebooking live.
While we're on Facebook Live.
On the interwebs.
Has that ever happened? Double Facebook Live.
It's like Inception. All right.
There you go, man. Preach to us, man.
All right, here we are. We're Facebooking live on double Facebooking live with Facebook going everywhere. That's really weird to me. Okay, all right. Well, let me turn my ringer off, just because I'm not an important person, but it would be awkward if it went off. Hi, guys. Thanks for having me. Thank you for letting me be a part of Redemption Church. I'm so excited to get to be a part, just a small part of what God's doing with you guys. And Chris called me last month and said, hey, Eric, you know, we haven't seen each other in a long time. Why don't you come down and we'll hang out and carry the cross in the city and hang out with my church. And so I said, that would be great. I would love to. And so y'all can get to know me just a little bit. My name's Eric Smith. I was born and raised in Waco, Texas, still there. And I have a beautiful wife, Julie, and my two kids, Nariah and Cannon. I don't have a picture of them right now. They do exist, just trust me. From Waco. And me and my wife lived in China on the border of North Korea for a little bit. And while I was there, God started speaking to me about building a cross and walking with it. And I don't know about y'all, but God speaks sometimes and he puts something that's way above us or something that's other than that we can't ever attain to. And when he speaks those words, you're like, I know about me, I was like, no way. I'm scared. I love to talk to people, but I don't like to be like the sore thumb. I want to be the cool person or something, you know. I don't want to be the person that people laugh at. And And so I remember being in China, and I was I just turned 29, and my wife took me to this place in Beijing for a retreat to kind of celebrate and to get away from everything. And so I fall asleep one night, and I have this really interesting dream. And the dream is this. I'm in a dark, candlelit room, and I see Jesus come walking into the room. And I wish I could say it was like a sweet moment. It was more like a moment where you would meet like a celebrity, like someone that you've seen on TV all your life, but you've never met. And I see Jesus walking in, and the first thing that happens in my heart is like, that's Jesus. Like, there he is. He's real, you know. I hope I don't have that response when I get to heaven. Like, you're real, you know, like, you know. But I see him, and he starts walking closer to me, and he has a smile on his face. And as he's looking at me, he says, Eric, anything's possible when you trust in me. And he gets a little closer till I can see him like right here, like face to face. And Jesus said, just trust me. And when he said that, the dream, you know, the dream kind of turned into another scene where I was asleep in a bed, and Jesus turned into this giant piece of bread and fell on top of me, and the dream ended. And I woke up, and I was like, that is so weird. You know, like, what does that mean? I have no idea what that means. And, you know, I'm like, okay, he's the bread of life. He's got me covered. He's, you know, he's my provision. I got to trust him, you know. So the next morning, I'm trying to spend time with him, just praying. And I'm like, God, what do you want to say to me? It's my 29th birthday. What do you like to say? And when I say God spoke to me, I don't know if y'all have ever had this experience, but it's like you feel a feeling in your heart and you get these thoughts in your mind. And I've had, you know, I believe he can speak to us audibly. I believe he speaks to us in dreams. I believe God wants to speak to us in many different ways. We just have to listen. Yeah. And so I'm asking Jesus what he wants to say. And I don't even remember where I was, Chris, in Psalms, but I was reading the book, a book in Psalms, and a chapter in Psalms. And all of a sudden, I hear God speak to my heart, I want you to carry a cross. And I was like, no, no, that's weird, you know. And I've, to be full disclosure, I have friends that carry a cross that has done that for like 30 years, you know, or 25 years. So that's not something that's completely foreign to me. What is foreign to me is that Eric, who is scared of confrontation, that is scared of conflict, would be willing to put a cross on his shoulder and go into neighborhoods, go into different countries, go try to travel around the world and tell the story of Jesus. That is something I would like to do with someone else, not me do it personally. Does that make sense? And so he said, hey, why don't you build a cross and walk with it? So I go and tell Julie, and Julie's like, we can pray about that. And I was like, no, we don't pray about that. And like we say, you're supposed to say, Eric, you're crazy. We're not doing that. We live in China, you know. And sometimes I feel like God, he speaks to us, and he's asking us to trust in him. You know, he's asking us to take him at face value, that he has good plans for us, guys. He's got good plans for you. But sometimes it takes us stepping out of our comfort zone where we're at. I'm not saying just throw caution to the wind and just do whatever you feel. I'm saying, you know, we got to prayerfully consider what we feel like God is saying, and then we submit it to each other and ask each other, well, you know, is this really you, God? Is this really what he's saying? We can't just be scared and hide from what we feel like God is saying, you know? And so I was scared. I decided to hide it. I was like, I'm not going to do that. And a few weeks later, I'd say actually about 2 months later, we're in China still. And me and my wife finally decide to talk about what it could be like. Can I step down? Is that Facebook? Can you see me? No, you don't? Sorry, that light's in my eyes. So here's the thought. I mean, here's what happened. I'm sitting there in this coffee shop with my wife, and I decide to finally open up and just say, hey, what could hurt about talking about it? We can at least talk about it. And I'm talking to my wife, And as I'm saying, hey, what would it look like for us to actually build a cross and walk with it, you know? And this thought comes into my mind about a dream that I had. God tends to speak to me through dreams, and I'll explain how all that happened in a minute. But when I first gave my life to Jesus, I had this dream. And the dream was this. I was standing on a highway that just went one direction, you know, that way. And I hear this loud noise behind me. And it's really startling. So I spin around to see what the noise is. And I see Jesus. And Jesus has a giant cross on his shoulder, bigger than this one. And it looks like somebody has hurt Jesus. Like they hit him a whole bunch. And he hadn't had any water to drink. I don't know why that was standing out to me in the dream. But it was like he was thirsty and he couldn't hardly talk. And he's dragging this cross on his shoulder, like tugging it. And he walks up to me and he drags the cross up to me, and his nose is almost touching my nose. And he said, like in a really desperate kind of voice, he said, "Would you remain with me? Would you remain with me like that?" And the first thing that came out of my heart was, "Yes, Lord, I'll remain with you." And then the dream was like, boom, gone, just like that. Well, when Jesus first set me free, I didn't know what Christians knew or didn't know. I didn't know how he talked to people, so I thought that was just like a dream Christians get. I don't know. I was just like, I guess that's the Jesus cross dream that Christians get, you know? And I just, you know, I didn't know enough to, like, go talk to somebody about it. So years later, that was when I was about 22, when Jesus really set me free. When I'm 29 now in China, and I'm sitting here at this coffee shop, and that dream hits me like a train. It's like right in my heart, and I'm like, whoa. And this thought is like, you're serious. That's what that dream was about. You were telling me when I was 22, you were asking me if I would walk with you. And now I'm 29, and you're calling it back again. You're saying, Eric, would you walk with me? Would you tell people the story of what I did for them? And so in that moment, I told my wife, I was like, babe, he's asking me to build a cross and to walk and to tell his story, to tell people, to tell you guys that he loves you, that Jesus cares about you, that it's not just a story that we tell our kids to make people feel better. It's a real life story. Jesus came and he lived and he died a horrible death just to tell you how much he loves you. And then he came back to life saying that even death itself cannot keep Jesus' love away from you. There is nothing that can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Paul said that, right? And he meant it. He experienced Jesus, right? He was a guy on the Damascus Road. You know, he'd been persecuting Christians. He thought he was doing God's work. Like, how many are... That's another preach we can go on, you know? Like, but here he is doing things that he thinks is for God. He's hurting people, and he has this encounter with Jesus, and he's changed forever, right? And so my goal, I guess, is to go around with the cross, and I'm asking God constantly to give people, I guess, Paul experiences where they would see the light and they would understand who Jesus is, that he loves them, that he cares about them, that there's no place Jesus wouldn't go for them. And I guess that's the only reason I'm here. I always tell people wherever I speak, I bring the cross. Sometimes it's awkward because we're in really little rooms. And like we're all up here and the cross is like squeaking into the room. But I'm like, hey, that's the only reason I'm here is because Jesus and what he did for us on the cross. And I'm walking around and shouting out, hey, he hasn't forgotten you. He hasn't forgotten you. He hasn't forgotten you, Redemption Church. Or even though the people that are new here, he hasn't forgotten you. He could never forget about his little person that he loved and he made and he created. I don't know how many of you have had kids in this room, but I have two little ones, and I can't think about leaving them. And I love being with them. I think about them all the time, and I'm like, how much more does Jesus think that way about me and about you? Like... what if we took God at face value? You know what I mean? Like, what if we looked in the dictionary about God? It says creator God made what, 7 billion people created the mountains and the stars and the trees and the ocean. And he considers us his children. And if God is that good to create all these beautiful things we have, you can't tell me he doesn't love us more than we love our own kids, more than we love our spouse, more than we love whatever else you can think of. He loves you more than that. Jesus is desperate for you. Amen. And so speaking, transition now. Talking about Jesus' affections for us, I didn't know that when I was growing up. I mean, I had experienced it a little bit, but I was more like head knowledge. You know, you can know stuff without really knowing stuff. You know, it's like a gun, right? You could like read all about how to shoot a gun, but you never shot a gun. So when you actually go to the archery range, I've shot a lot of guns. because archery is for bow and arrow. Okay, it's a terrible joke. Anyway, you can know all about it, but then when you actually practically try to do it, you miss the target, you know? And I think the love of God isn't just something we can know, it's something we have to experience and know. And so I grew up in a family I went to a Baptist church. My dad had a lot of anger issues, and he didn't always know how to show you handle it well. You know, he would just kind of lash out at us. Love my dad. He just didn't know how to handle himself. You know, and my dad ended up getting a heart attack when he was, 44, and he died when he was 45. So I was about 15 years old when my dad passed away. And so had to learn a lot of things on my own. Kind of dove into church and tried to figure out who Jesus was. And so, you know, got into church, and we do our little small groups and in the youth. And I would lead those sometimes, and I could tell people about Jesus, and I'd pray for people. But all the while in my heart, I thought maybe God was angry at me because my dad used to get angry, you know. Maybe God gets angry at me if I mess up. So I didn't really think that forgiveness was real. I thought it was conditional, I guess. But for everybody else, maybe it was like, God, he forgave you, you know. So carry that kind of thought process on. When I was about 21, I remember saying, hey, I'm not going to try to follow Jesus anymore because I don't know if I'm saved anyway or if he'd even forgive someone like me. So I just decided to give in to drinking and drugs and partying and living for whatever I wanted to. And all the while in my heart, I was hurting because I really wanted Jesus to be happy and forgiving and everything that I'd heard about, but I just hadn't experienced it, you know? And now, when I'm carrying the cross on the street, I'm always telling people, give him a chance. Just give him a chance. I think the most brave thing we could ever do is ask Jesus to tell us what he thinks about us and to sit quietly and to really just ask him to speak. And I was terrified of that because I thought for sure Jesus would be like, yeah, bro, you can't be with me. You've messed up. And so I remember sitting at my house. I had gone on a few trips the season of my life. Even though I was drinking and partying, I was trying to follow God anyway, which is really weird. I don't know if anybody else has tried to both feet in, you know, one foot in the world, one foot with Jesus, and you're like, I'm just trying to figure out who's right, you know. And I guess people call it riding the fence, but I was kind of like straddling the fence, you know, kicking both legs and in both worlds, you know. And I'd gone on mission trips and in my heart, I knew the way I'd been living my life was wrong, but I also felt like abandoned and alone. And so I'm sitting in this living room at my house, and I hadn't done any drinking or drugs for a while. I always preface that because people are like, yeah, you get a lot of dreams. Maybe it was all that, you know, stuff. But I hadn't done stuff in 6 months, you know, and I didn't really do much drugs. It was mainly just drinking, but I'm kind of a full disclosure person. Sorry. I'll tell you anything and everything you ask about me. So I'm sitting in this house, and my in my apartment with my friends, and they were all asleep because I had just come back from a trip and I was kind of jet lagging, so I couldn't sleep. And so it was about 6 in the morning, and I got up and I started washing my roommate's dishes, and I started getting angry at God. And I was like, God, I don't know why I can't be with you. I feel like those Hallmark cards you see where you have the kids standing in the snow and they're looking through the window and you see all the kids opening presents by the fire and they're laughing and hugging each other, you know? And I told Jesus that day. I was like, I feel like that kid, Jesus. I feel like that kid that doesn't understand what other Christians have, so I don't want to try anymore. And then I told the devil, I was like, devil, and I know you're real, and I know you're evil, and you try to take my friends away, you take my relationships away. I have nightmares all the time. I don't want you in my life anymore either. Then I went down into my living room, and I sat down, and I didn't know what to do. I just started crying, because I felt like there was no world for me, there was no life for me. And I didn't, like I said, I didn't know what to do. So I just started to cry. And then the weirdest thing happened to me. I saw a picture. My eyes were open, but I saw this giant picture, kind of like the screen over there or over here. And like this giant flat screen, although there wasn't flat screens back then. And this screen of me was, the screen I saw was of me dying on a cross. And the first thought that goes through my mind is, oh no, don't see that. I'm more messed up than I thought. I really had that thought. I was like, Jesus died on the cross, not me. You know, like, stop seeing it. So I remember trying to rub my eyes, and I could not stop seeing this picture of me dying on a cross. Next, I see in the picture is Jesus walk in, and he's like over here, and he comes walking into the picture. And he's laughing and smiling. And all this anger in my heart came out towards Jesus. And I remember sitting on that floor and I was literally pointing at this vision or picture, whatever you want to have, whatever you want to call it. And I remember saying, that's what I feel like, Jesus. I feel like my whole life I've been hanging on a cross and suffering on my own. And you're happy being God and doing your own thing. Why? Well, don't you see me, Jesus? Don't you see me? And Jesus gets a little closer, and I notice that Jesus has tears in his eyes, and he's laughing, like happy laughing, and he says something, and I hear Jesus' voice. And when I say I heard it, it was like my whole body heard it and felt it. I heard Jesus say, there you are. And this thought came through my mind like wildfire, and the thought was this, that maybe my whole life Jesus has been looking for me. Guys, to this day, I can't tell it without getting so emotional. I get so excited because it was like winning the lotto. Guys, Jesus, he's been looking for us. He's been waiting for us to turn to him, like all the time. All the time. He makes the sunset for us to notice it. He makes the sunrise, the wind blow. He provides for you when you don't even know it. Like he's just hoping, maybe today. I see Jesus all the time. Maybe today they'll look. Maybe today they'll look. Maybe today the day is the day they'll see me and they'll know that I love them and that I care about them and that I'll take care of every need that they have. But they gotta just look. They gotta trust. They gotta believe that I love them. You know, I pray they would just turn and look at me today. So I see this, I hear Jesus say that, and me with all these issues that I'd had and believed who God was, although he wasn't that, I'm coming undone. So I remember crying really hard and feeling like this is too good to be true. Here's Jesus, and he walks up to me, and then I see Jesus take my left arm off the cross. He pulls my right arm off the cross, and then Jesus scoops down and he takes my feet off the cross, and he's holding me like you would hold your kid, like a dad would hold a child, you know? And he's holding me like this in his arms, and I'm like, is this really happening? And I tell people it was a vision, like I'm seeing it, but then it was like I was happening to me, and I don't really know what happened. All I know is that I met Jesus that day. And next, in the picture, Jesus says, you are never alone. And I felt God come from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. And I lost it. I realized in that moment what salvation was. It's a relationship with Jesus. You know? And I realized that it's not about me being good. It's not about me not trying to do bad things. It's about me letting Jesus have life with me. You know, Jesus, he just wants to live his life with you. He's not trying to control you. Yeah. He's a happy dad. And I know a lot of us have had hard things happen in our lives. And we're like, how do you explain that? I'm like, I don't know how to explain it except for we live in a fallen world and there's an evil devil. But there's a good God who cares about you. And he has good plans for you. It says in Jeremiah 29:11, for I have good plans for you, declares the Lord. Plans of a future and a hope. Plans to prosper you and not harm you. And so right then as he said that, he said, now watch. And I saw Jesus set me down on this big rock. And then I saw Jesus climb up on the cross. And I saw Jesus just staring at me. And I saw Jesus start to cry. And then I saw Jesus having a hard time breathing. And I couldn't stop seeing it, even though I wanted to stop seeing it. And then and it was like over, like a wave, you know? Like, have you ever been standing in the ocean and you get hit by a wave and you can't help but be pushed back by it? That was the feeling, was like this overwhelming feeling of Jesus really came. Like, he really came. Like I said it a minute ago, it's a true story. Jesus really came. And he came for one purpose, and that was to get you. He came to rescue you. He came to help you. And he wants to live his life with you. And so much so that he was willing to put down everything he's ever loved and ever been to be by your side. You mean the world to Jesus. Literally, you mean the world to him. I remember watching him hanging there on the cross, and the thought was like, it's a true story, and he's way better than anybody's ever told me. He's way kinder than anybody could have ever explained. And I remember crying for a few hours after that. And, you know, it wasn't like after that moment I became missionary man. No, it was Eric goes to counseling. And I got involved in a church, and I remember telling our church counselor everything I'd ever done and letting my friends get involved in my life and getting in community. And I think, you know, there's two things that I always tell people if they want a touch from Jesus, if they want to meet him, is one, we got to come clean with the things that scare us and the things that we're afraid of. For years, y'all know my story was not telling anybody, and I was afraid that Jesus would reject me, and I would never tell anyone. It's just funny because on the trip, right before I had the encounter with Jesus, I had finally told my friends that I didn't think I could be saved and that I didn't think Jesus would love me. I remember my friends saying, hey, that's not true, but the lies were still in there. But I'd finally told it and got it out. And so I feel like when we confess, I'm not just asking you to confess for confession's sake. You don't have to tell me anything. I'm talking about between you and God and getting the things you're afraid of out of your heart before him, because he already knows they're there. And when we ask Jesus to come and we're asking him to, like, hey, I don't want this in my life anymore, and we get it out in the open, he can come. And it sets us up. I always say it's a setup for a God encounter. Two, is staying in community. Like, you guys are a beautiful church. Staying together and helping others come alongside and walking others out. They might have a cool God story, but they need the body of Christ to be Christ to them and help them out of their situation, you know? So after a few years of walking in community and walking out, me and my wife became missionaries to China, and then that's where God said, I want you to build a cross and start walking with it. So a couple of months after that encounter with Jesus, where me and my wife decided to carry the cross, we came home and we built a cross and started walking with it. And so it's about to be 9 years. 9 years I've been carrying the cross on my shoulder now, and I've been to a lot of places, Wales, England, Ireland, Haiti, Ghana, Belize, you name it, Mexico, Honduras, Nicaragua, El Salvador. And everywhere I go, there's this thing that I find. Even in the U.S., everywhere I go, and it's called loneliness. I find people that are so lonely all the time. And Jesus came to put the lonely in homes. He's come to give people life. And the message of the cross is that someone loves you and was willing to lay their life down for their friend. Jesus said, no greater love than this, than one to lay their life down for their friend. And so I always say, that's what I want to try to do, is lay my life down for my friend. And that's what I see your church doing, is trying to lay your life down for your friends. And sometimes it's easy to forget when things get hard, or we don't see things going the way we want them to go. But it's time like that where I think it's just, we just die to ourselves and say, I'm laying my life down for my friend. I'm laying my life down for Jesus, because he laid his life down for me. And I don't know, I could go so many different directions from here, but we've seen people healed. We've seen people, my friends that come with me with carrying the cross, people healed or saved. And always, my wife knows me really the best. She's always like, Eric knows it's a good trip when he sees someone cry. And to me, it's because they get it. They hear that, they feel the love of God. Not that you have to cry to meet God. That's not what I'm saying. Just for me, it's like a sign, just like the cross, that God's stirring the pot. You know, he's touching hearts on the street. And so we'll have cars stop and people get out of the road. They get out of the car and come running down the road with tears running down their face. And they have no idea what's going on. Like one time, I was just finished carrying the cross. I'd set it down and I was praying. I was like, Lord, thank you for today. Just let it bless people. Let people come to know you because of today. And this white Mustang pulls up. And this sweet, cool guy jumps out of the car. And he's like, comes running up. And he's like, bro. He's like, you waved at me the other day. And I heard a voice talk to me. Oh, no. Sorry. That's coming. He says, you waved at me and I started crying. And I have no idea what it was about. I just started crying in my car. Today I see you and I hear a voice say, go talk to that guy. So talk to me. You know? So I kind of ask him a few questions, and the guy's like, man, I've always wanted to know Jesus, but we grew up in a non-religious home whatsoever. And so I know nothing. Tell him about Jesus. Guy totally gives his life to Jesus. And then bought me a donut, which that was up to him. I didn't ask for a donut. But God rocked him. And I see people like all the time, we're just random stories where people start crying and they run up and they're like, somebody, like, today was so hard and I needed to see it and you're here. And I never drive this way. I just thought I was supposed to drive this way. And the Spirit of God touched my heart. And so, to say all that, God can use even the silliest thing. Some dude that's carrying a cross that's probably not even the cross that looked like what Jesus carried, you know. But he uses me because he loves me and he loves us. And he says he'll use the foolish things to shame the wise. And so I say that not about me, but about to you guys, that God wants to use you. It doesn't matter what venue you're in or what vocation or location you're at. Like, God wants to use you to see people's lives changed. But first, he wants to change your life. And I find myself, I always tell people to come to the cross, and we'll do that in a minute. But I go to the cross all the time. And what I mean is going to the cross. It's not like I always kneel down by this cross. It's I go before Jesus and say, Jesus, you know I haven't been living the way I know I'm supposed to live, or I know I'm not the man I want to be, God, but I know you see my heart, and I just surrender it again and say, help me to follow you. And then also, I always ask him, what do you think about me, Jesus? What do you want to say? And a lot of times, I'll hear a little voice in my heart saying, I love you, I like you, I'm proud of you. Keep going, you know. And then I just go back out with the cross on my shoulder, praying for people and telling them that they're worth it, that Jesus thinks you're so special. And if I had a word for your church at all, it'd be that you're special, that he hasn't forgotten you, that he cares about you. And the other day I was talking about the Ark of the Covenant. It's been really dear to my heart lately. I don't know why. But God was speaking to me the other day and said, Eric, you know, there's not been one battle where the Ark of the Covenant was present that it didn't win. He's like, so when you gave your life to me, my spirit came into your heart and you became the Ark of the Covenant. I believe that's what makes every believer so special, is that they have the presence of God with them. And we forget it so often and we don't use it. But Jesus wants you to win your battles today. He wants you to overcome the hard things that have been in your life, those things you don't like about yourself. You know, like I see Jesus all the time. I see Jesus on the street, you know, in my mind. And him walking up to a crippled person and say, hey, I notice you don't want to be crippled anymore. I'll be crippled so you don't have to be. He walks up to the person that's anorexic and says, hey, you don't have to be anorexic anymore. I'll be that so you don't have to be that. He walks up to the prostitute. Hey, I'll become that so you don't have to be that. And I just see him walking through crowds and taking the things. Somebody feels ugly. Hey, I'll be ugly so you don't have to feel ugly anymore. And he's the best dad. That's the story of the cross, is Jesus, who knew no sin, became sin on our behalf. Like, the things you don't like about yourself, Jesus wants to take away today. The things that are hard in your life, he wants to be with you in it. Does that make sense? I'm not saying, he didn't say that you're not going to have trials. He said, in this world, you're going to have trials. But lo, I'm with you always. He's with you. He wants to help you win your battles. And so this might have been a short message or a long message. I don't know. I like the word message. But I, in my heart, I just want people to come to the cross today and to say, Jesus, you know, there's probably stuff in my life I want to get straight with you. Or I want to know that you love me. I want to encounter from you. I want more. There's always more. I believe there's so much more. And I believe we can have it. And so I bring the cross everywhere I go. And it's kind of like, hey, God has come. Just to remind us that he's here. And the good news is that I'm going to leave. And when I leave, it's a message to your church and to my friends, to the people that see me, that God is wanting to drag away the horrible things that have been in your life that have been plaguing you. I really believe it. I really believe he wants to, like, touch you today. So can we get to worship up, some music on or something, and say, you know, yeah, I don't really have to say anything. Jesus says it all, you know. And you are special to him, and he loves you, and he cares about you. And so I'm going to ask, if y'all want, now we're just going to worship. But if you want to come to the cross and say, Jesus, there's something I don't want anymore, would you take it? You can do that. Or you can sit in your chair and do it. I think it's just time to just say, Jesus, there's things I want you to have. And mainly, I want you to have my heart more, Lord. And I don't even know how to do that, but I just want you to do that for me. And so I'm going to pray over us now. Is that okay if I pray and just ask Jesus to come? Lord, thank you for this beautiful church. And I just ask that you would come and that you would bless my friends in the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask you would put your hand on us today, and I just see God breathing, and it's like his breath is breathing over us. And would you breathe on my friends today? Would you renew them? Would you strengthen them? Lord, I pray that you would be lifted up in our lives. We love you, Lord. We give our lives to you, and I pray for your power to be released here. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Redemption Church, you just heard an authentic message about how God loves you. And when you think you understand He loves you, you haven't scratched the surface. He loves you all the more. We do three things every time we come together. We've worshiped God together. You just heard the Word of God together. Now, all over this house, could you just stand to your feet? I want to invite you to talk to God. I would like to challenge you, like Eric just challenged you, to come to the cross today. Why don't you just come grab a hold of this cross today and have a time of prayer. If you're in this place and you want somebody to pray with you, if you felt something in your heart and you're just like, I don't even know what all this means, but I want to know more, or I want somebody to pray with me, I've got needs in my life, why don't you come in the first 2 feet of this stage right here? And that just lets us know that you want us to pray with you, and we'll do that. I challenge you right now to take a step. As they begin to sing, I want you to begin to talk to God and to call on His name all over this house. Come on, let's come. Thank you, Father.
For more information about Redemption, look us up online at redemption-church.com. We want to hear from you, so be sure to connect with us on Facebook, Twitter, or even our anonymous question text line at 214-856-0550. Thank you for joining us, and have a blessed day.